Thank you so much for inviting me. Well, I should say that I first got acquainted with you, wonderful mathematics, when I was a student in the 70s. But we met first in the 90s, and since then Luke is a dear friend, an amazingly kind and gentle person, deeply appreciating books, music, and nature. And thank you, Luke, and many happy returns of the day. This is a small blog, small work with Spencer, and let me start with a construction due to him of some cycles homologically equivalent to zero. And as usual, all we know that cycles homologically equivalent to zero are interesting objects and construct them as a sort of arc. So we start with a family of algebraic varieties over a complex disk. And the initial point is zero is here. I assume that Y is smooth. And the only singular point of F have just one point, Y zero. And it sits in the fiber over zero. And the point is quadratic. Let's consider the blow up of y zero at this point. Let's call it x. And then we see that the exceptional divisor, the fiber of pi over small y zero, is an undegenerate quadric. It's denoted by q. Let's assume that the dimension of y equals to n. To n. And then q has dimension 2n minus 2, and so we can it's even dimensional quadric, and so we have its two rulings, and a definition I will refer as Bloch cycle. B is the difference of two rulings of the two rulings of Q, but I want to view it as an element of the Chow group of X. Well, the codimension would be N. So again, we consider I'm not lying on the quadric, but inside of who X, and you can ask if this cycle would be homologically equivalent to zero. And here is a small lemma. The next conditions are equivalent. So the first one is that B is homologically equivalent to zero. The second one would be this. Let's consider the local system of cohomology over the puncture disc and the monodromy action. On, well, I consider cohomology of degree 2n minus 1 of fibers with the rational coefficients, and it is non-trivial.
Osha?
Yep.
We don't see the bottom line.
You don't see the bottom line. Okay, so I will. Okay, so let me pass to the next whiteboard and write.
No, but we lost. What was the previous one? What is not
now we don't see anything.
Oh, now you don't see anything. Okay, so I will try to go a bit below. Unfortunately, I don't know how to scroll the thing. Oh, Bjorn sees it all. Okay, so the monodromy is non-trivial. Okay. Well, okay, so anyway. Well, so this condition often, and you check actually the second certainly, and this happens pretty often. And for example, let's consider the case when n equals to 1. And this means that we have a family of curves, and with degeneration with single quadratic points, point, and there could be two possibilities. We have either one component or two irreducible components of the fiber. And in the first case, the local monodromy is non-trivial, so the lemma, the conditions of the lemma hold, and in the second case it's trivial. Maybe I should also say that if we get our family from a Lefschetz pencil on a given variety, then the conditions of lemma will be met if the degree of the Lefschetz pencil is sufficiently high. Okay, now let's formulate. Let me try to formulate the theorem. Well, let's consider.
Assume the family is proper by when you wrote.
Yes, yes. I assume that it's proper. Sorry that I did not tell it. Well, from now on, I will assume that the condition of the lemma are met. Now, consider our family variation of mixed Hodge structures that I mentioned in the lemma. Q, and maybe I will twist it by N to make it. To have it weight minus one. And then I denote by E the limited Hodge structure. In other words, the nearby cycles for this local system. Now, since the monodromy is non-trivial and the point is quadratic, then it's fairly easy to see how the Hodge structure, how E would look like. It will have three weights. Minus two, minus one, and zero. And the associated graded quotients for the weight filtration. The zeros one will be isomorphic to Q of zero. The next one uh, is actually intersection cohomology of degree 2 n minus 1 of the singular fiber. Just a moment. Something bad is with pencil. I should call my daughter. Wait a moment, please.
Верка!
Could you help me? The pencil stopped writing. Okay. Now.
Try now.
Okay. Wonderful. Okay, and the one weight minus 2 is Q1. Again, it's isomorphic to Q of 1. Not exactly canonical as here, but at least you can, if you consider the action of the monodromy of the thing, then the top and the bottom quotient are identified by the operator 1 minus monodromy, or monodromy minus 1, I don't know. Okay, that's an isomorphism. So the picture, looks like this. And now let's also look at the Hodge structure on E. Let's look at as a real Hodge structure. And then there is abstraction to its splitting as a real Hodge structure. As always, when we have weights which are next to each other, then the thing splits as our Hodge structure. But there is could be a non-trivial abstraction of splitting of the whole thing. This would be actually a real number. Oh, hola. Yes, an R Hodge structure. This is a real number which is defined, could be defined as follows. Take a generator in the quotient Q of 0 and say 1, and then we can lift it to say 1 tilde, which lie in the 0 term of the Hodge filtration. And then we can actually lift it so that its difference minus with the complex conjugate to itself, so the imaginary part of 1 tilde, will actually lie in the minus 2 term of the Hodge filtration. There is a choice of such lifting. This is a real number, which is imaginary part of this is our abstraction. And I don't know the right name, maybe I don't know Hodge local index or something like this. The theorem gives an interpretation of this abstraction to splitting in terms of it relates it to the Bloch cycle. Well, to explain it, let's consider the situation when everything is defined over Q. Everything, I mean, the family came from a family of curves over over Q. And also the let's assume that the block cycle is also defined over Q. Then we can consider the height. So the block cycle is logically equivalent to zero because of our assumption and the lemma. And so we can consider its height pairing with itself. And the theorem asserts that actually this height pairing, and I will recall how you define it, is actually equal to this abstraction, to the splitting of the Hodge structure on the limited Hodge structure that we talked about. Of E. Well, let me formulate it more modestly that this will be not equation of two real numbers, but modulo combinations with rational coefficients of logarithms of primes. In a sense, you have to do it because if you multiply our function f by some rational number, non-zero rational number, then certainly the zero fiber would not change and the height pairing would not change, but this abstraction to the splitting will be multiplied by the logarithm, one should add to it the logarithm of the number multiply our function over. So you will get this. But in fact, there is some unfortunately conjectural on the level of our due to our ignorance at the moment. So modulo some rationality conjecture, there will be actually true equality of the numbers. And again, I will say a few words about this. Let me say that this theorem is actually very easy, and the proof is essentially a recollection of all the definitions, and then it comes by itself. Though the two numbers are seemingly different, but still the proof is quite easy. So what I will do, I will explain actually a geometric version of this assertion, and then say a few words how to change, what should be changed to in the argument to make the arithmetic statement. So I need to recall the collection on the height pairing. Well, I should say that I was playing with this a long, long ago in the middle of the 80s, and somehow both at that time, the two subjects, the height pairing and vanishing cycle, somehow became disjointed in my head, and this work is just an attempt to draw thread between two seemingly different points. Well, in the geometric story, what I will do is to replace. So before we considered Q, family of curves over Q, and now I will replace Q by the generic point of a smooth complex curve. I see, and let's see what will happen. So we have a smooth complex curve C. And we will consider its smooth compactification the smooth compactification C bar. And below we will play all our shifts will be, we will play with Q shifts, Q hot shifts as were defined by Marihika Saita. So always everything I will do, this will be about Q hot shifts. Well, now suppose that we have on our C, we have a local system of weight one. Weight minus one. Okay, and that, then we can extend it as usually by an intermediate extension, or which is by invariance of local monodromy. Well, and now I need the following lemma, which comes very easily, just playing a little bit with weights. And the claim is that let's consider extensions the group X to one of extensions between Q of zero on C bar and the middle extension. And then we can restrict to X1 of Q of zero C, well, and H. So we consider extensions of hot shifts, constant shifts with H on the compact curve and restricting it to extensions over C. And the claim is that the thing is actually that the map is an isomorphism. Well, now this helps to define a canonical pairing on the right hand side for the reason that, well, we have Poincaré duality. For the middle extension. To Q. Well, and then certainly we have a map from the corresponding we can pass to these are pure Hodge structures which pair into Q of zero, and then we can pass to to Hodge cycles inside from Q of zero to these spaces, and then we will get a non-degenerate pairing from this, and this groups maps to certainly maps to Hodge cycles inside of each one of C bar with coefficients in H. So we have pairing between the corresponding group for H and H star of one. And so we have the pairing on the corresponding X groups. Okay, so let me let me write it down. Okay, so and we can use the lemma and just invert the arrow. So we have a map from the pairing between x1 of q of zero on C and H. And the second group will be similar thing for H star of one, but I prefer to rewrite it just passing two dual extensions as X1 between H and Q of one. And then we have the pairing to Q. So again, so we used here the lemma in order to pass from the extensions of Hodge local systems on curve to the corresponding extensions between their middle extensions on compactification, where you do have the Poincaré duality. And this I will call the height pairing. The nice thing is that there is a way to compute, there is a global height pairing, but there is a way to compute it using local invariants, some local invariants. But in order to define this invariants, we should have some extra data. Well, the extra data would be a local system E. On C, with the following properties. So, the following extra identification. So the weights should be minus two, minus one, and zero, and also we should have the identifications of the associated graded quotients. This should be Q of zero. This should be H, and minus two quotient is Q of one. Well, now maybe I should have said before that suppose that we have two elements of the corresponding X groups. One is I will call alpha, and the second I will call alpha V. And my aim is to try to compute compute their height pairing. Well, now the assumption is that we have this identification such that the corresponding classes of extension of this would be alpha, and of that would be alpha v. Now, given such E, we can define the local indices. Maybe let me denote in this manner, x, and this will be a rational number, and they will be defined for every x at the infinity point of C. So we consider the complement of C in C bar, and then to every point, so given such an E, then I can define a local index. So let me define it. Well, in order to define it, let's consider the middle extension now of E to the whole of C bar. Well, maybe even let's do the shift so to make by one, so to make our things perverse. And let's look how this middle extension would look like. Well, now it's easy to see that, it will have, so E shifted by one now has weight zero. And so the whole thing could have, E shifted by one will have weights zero plus and minus one, and their middle and the middle extension would look like this. So you have the top associated quotient is Q of zero. Now the zero, the middle weight quotient of the thing looks as follows. Well, so first it is a pure shift of weight zero, and so it splits, and it splits into pieces since its restriction to the to C equals E, then the thing would be just a direct sum of some delta, which is supported at C bar, skyscraper supported at infinity at C bar minus C, and the middle extension of E. Well, and then we have the bottom part, and this is certainly usual shifts of perverse. Well, so now we can define
E or H?
It was E. No, it's H. I'm sorry. Yes, you are perfectly right. It's H, yes. Yeah, you are right. Sorry. Well, now we can define the number. We know that we have successive extension, so we can consider classes of X1. So we know that classes of Q of zero by means of H is alpha. And here we have class which is alpha V. But now we have extension also of Q of zero by delta, by the skyscraper shift, and let's call it beta. And here we will have beta V. And we can compose them, beta and beta V. And then we will get a number. So for delta is skyscraper at C bar minus C. So it's the same as if we do everything at every point at infinity. And so we get a collection of numbers because, it's composition of two X1. So it's X2 with support in a point at infinity. And this is just Q. So, and by definition, this local index of E at a point at infinity, it is just, let's take number with minus sign. It is a composition of beta V beta, which is again, is viewed as X2 with support in X of Q of zero and Q of one. And this is a rational number. Okay, so for every point at infinity, we have local index, and it is essentially immediate that the sum of this lemma that the sum of these local indices equals the height pairing of alpha and alpha v. Well, it's immediate because, well, here, if you just look at this successive extension of Gar W, you see that the composition of two X2s, one, this one, which has two component alpha and beta, and another, which have component alpha V and beta V, is zero as element in X2. And this is exactly alpha, alpha V and plus beta beta V and so on. So it's essentially an obvious assertion. So, but it is very useful for the following reason. Well, first question is how to find E. Well, it's E, this E, first, the abstraction to the existence of E lies in well, if you just look at it, it lies in X2 of Q of zero on C and Q of one on C. And this is the same as Picard group of C, well, tensor Q. And so shrinking C, you can find E. And also I did not say, but I should have said that that this pairing, height pairing itself, it does not depend on, if we shrink C, it does not change. Locally and different E, well, it's if we have such sort of a double extension, that certainly if we have just an extension of Q of zero by Q of one, we can consider the bar sum of it with E, and we get another E. And it's easy to see that this makes the set of all E's a torsor over X1 between Q of zero and Q of one, and this is just invertible functions on C. If there is one E, this will be a torsor. So essentially, so we have just a torsor with respect to invertible function standard Q on our curve. So this is the data of E, and it's easy to see how local the global certainly the global height pairing does not depend on the choice of E, and dependence on E. On E of the local indices, certainly if I would just add, translate E by means of an invertible function F here, then the corresponding pairings this will be the sum of, certainly I don't remember the sign, but let's take it plus the divisor of F at X. So that is a picture. Well, now let me formulate. Let me explain what the story has to do with algebraic cycles, and then I will explain how the global theorem comes. The geometric version of the theory, comes. Well, suppose that we have that eta, height pairing of algebraic cycles. Suppose that we have eta, let eta be generic point of C. And we have a smooth projective variety x eta over eta. Well, of the and suppose that we have two elements of the Chow groups, alpha Chow group of codimension I of x eta, and we have alpha v, which sits in Chow j of x eta. And I want that I and j I will be chosen so that I plus j equals, that they would not intersect, but just a bit. So it will be dimension over eta plus one. Okay. So. And then suppose also that alpha and alpha v are homologically equivalent to zero on the generic geometric fiber. Well, in this situation, can the previous construction, they help to define the pairing of their height pairing, and this will be a rational number. And in order to define it, we should just apply the previous construction to to define, we should do the following. We should first spread our x eta to projective family over C. Let's say P. And then let's also spread our spread our cycles, and let's define H as the direct image of Q of I to I minus one of Q of I on X, and this will be a local system, and we will have the classes of alpha and alpha v exactly define the elements, because alpha and alpha v are homologically equivalent to zero on every fiber. They define the corresponding extension classes. We have which will lie in next one of Q of zero E and H, and same for alpha V, and we can just apply the previous construction. So this will be the global height pairing, but we also can define local height pairings, and the only procedure that I knew before was that we should pick representatives of alpha and alpha v as true algebraic cycles, and spread it so that the corresponding that the supports of the corresponding cycles over C would not intersect, and this is possible after shrinking C certainly, and then we can define our local system. Let me just write down E. Just write down its fibers. We consider first local system with fibers. Let A and B be the closures. Well, A and support of alpha and B in support of alpha V. And again, they do not intersect. And then we can consider the relative cohomology group for every fiber. We can consider the relative cohomology group of model B, and therefore certainly a local system on our curve. And we can use, the thing is not exactly extension by Q of zero by Q of one, but here will be a linear Q of zero power A, and here will be Q of one power B, and then we should use alpha and alpha V to pull back and push forward to get exactly E in the shape we had before. And then we will have local indices. This is a nice procedure. The only problem of it, for example, is that really in order to define the thing, we should have cycles with non-intersecting support. And for example, computing self-intersection is sort of a problem. But now let me explain how you a geometric version of the theorem. So we should do just what we did in case of theorem, but replacing a rational spectrum of rational numbers, which was a very base, by the generic point of C. So basically, this means the following: that we consider we have our curve, and we consider it inside of a surface T, and these are zeros of a function f. Then we have a family yt over t, and this is a projective, so yt to t is a projective map. And I assume that yt is smooth. And what I want is, and its dimension is 10 plus 1. What I assume is that all singular point, that the singularity of the projection of lie over C, and every fiber actually has a single quadratic singularities. So that's our picture. Here we can do just repeat everything that we did in the very beginning. We can y, this singular thing that lives over C. We have a section I, which assigns to a point of C the only singular point in the fiber. And then we can consider the blow up of YC at that point, and that will be X. The fiber over I is a non-degenerate quadric.
I want to understand, in your setup C is a complex curve, yes?
Yes.
What is T?
T is a surface?
T is a surface, yes.
And it lies over, well, it doesn't lie over any, okay.
No, and C is given by equation f equals to zero.
And they are complete or the
no, the projection from y to t is projective, and okay, yt is the about t I don't care, and I'm interested in it only near C. And actually, of C, I also interested in the generic point of C. So the base is not completable. Okay. Now again, I blow up YC at the singular point, and so I get something X over YC. X now is smooth, the exceptional divisor is. Q is will be a family of non-degenerate quadrics over C, and I can do the very same thing. I can consider I can define the Bloch cycle. I consider the two rulings of the quadrics. I consider their difference, and then I will get the Bloch cycle P. And I will consider it as an element of the Chow, of the middle Chow group of X tensor Q. Let's assume that the condition of the lemma, the very first lemma holds, so that if I consider the cohomology of non-singular fibers near C, then the local monodromy will be non-trivial. What were these degrees? 2n-1. Is non-trivial. Again, then B will be homologically equivalent to zero, and we can, in this situation, as I explained before, we can consider the as a self-Heit pairing. Oh, just a moment. So I should, just a moment. So, sorry, up. Okay. So we can ask what would be the corresponding self pairing. And the analog of the theorem is this. So we should consider again the local family, the local system of cohomology. So we consider local system E, and this will be the vanishing, the nearby cycles. They will lie over C, so will be a local system over C, and this will be applied to a local system which is defined on the complement. So it will be local system with fibers. H2n-1 of y s q of n. Now, if you look how E looks like, again you have three weights and the successive quotients. This will be q of zero on C, and then the next one minus one it will be the intersection cohomology of fiber wise of y zero with coefficient and intersection cohomology, and then again there will be Q1. And this is exactly the data we played of E on a curve we played with. And with this, we can associate the local indices and we can compute if you wish their sum. And the thing is that the corresponding global, the claim is that the corresponding, that the sum of these local indices is exactly the self-pairing of BB. And the reason for this is just to check it. We should just check that this, that the two extension, that the two extensions are correspond exactly to B. And this is maybe let me formulate. Well, I don't have time, but. Well, maybe let me just say that what happens in just a few words, what happens in the arithmetic situation. Everything could be done exactly as in geometry, except that for Q we have for spectrum of Z we should consider all points. There will be non-Archimedean points, and there will be Archimedean points, and the Hodge number we consider is actually the local, the analog of EX at non-Archimedean points. At Archimedean points. At non-Archimedean points, we have similar numbers, but to define them, we have to use Eliade cohomology. And the current level of our knowledge is, as far as I understand, is insufficient to know that they're actually rational numbers. But the moment we know that they are rational numbers, well, we will have both the height pairing is defined, and again, the height pairing is defined also only modulo this conjecture of rationality. And it will be automatically equal to the corresponding sum that comes from the nearby cycles. Hodge structure. Well, that's it.
So, thank you very much. Are there any questions? Luc?
I had a very naive question in the local situation, so the local pairing. Relative dimension one, so n is one.
Mm-hmm.
And quadratic singularity, and even I take a curve with semi stable reduction.
Uh-huh.
Then in this case, is there a relation between this height pairing, this local thing, local indices, I think you called them, and Pikalevschek's theorem and Gordon-Dix model of pairing?
Well, in a sense, they're different. Well, Gordon-Dix monodromy, well, both Pikalevschek's and Gordon-Dix monodromy, they are somehow inherently inside of the story. For example, this lemma that algebraic cycles, the classes of algebraic cycles cohomologically equivalent to zero can be extended to X1s for where on the completed curve with intermediate extension of cohomology itself, it uses, you really play with weights here. So you should have Gordon-Dix monodromy theorem.
Mm-hmm.
And in the definition of this local cycles, you also use it.
Mm-hmm.
And you use Becker-Lefschetz. It's just inside.
But in fact, in Gordon-Dix, you eventually arrive at the quadratic form, Z integral quadratic form. So take all the it was not so easy for L the prime to the characteristic, so it's comparatively easy. So it's decalation, but then so I wonder whether this more geometric approach could give a simpler definition of the potential underlying bearing and perhaps prove that it is in fact a perfect bearing.
Maybe to prove integrality in. In case of relative dimension one, you could prove integrality. This last thing that the local indices are actually not plain analytic numbers, but they are rational. Mm-hmm. But in hard dimension, I just have no idea.
Okay.
Any other questions?
So at the end, I didn't follow the role of T. It doesn't appear on the. So what was the role of T? I forgot. Maybe I was tired and I missed something. So T is the surface in which T is embedded. So it's some kind of thickening. Yeah. And so what is the role of T?
The role of small T, the parameter.
No, the capital, the surface.
The local monodromy. The local monodromy. The local monodromy of the family.
Local monodromy of what?
The local T was also, I think, denoted the local monodromy of the family. Mm-hmm. On the acting on the cohomology. Mm-hmm. And for example, T minus one identified the top weight quotient with the bottom weight quotient.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So can you formulate the problem in Eladic cohomology, and is the result that you mentioned in the beginning depend on this rationality? You said that the theorem is that something is equal modulo combination of log of prices rational coefficient, so it depends on some, so the result depends on the some conjecture or not?
The theorem is that I formulated in the beginning, no, it is not conjectural. If you do it modulo this q linear combinations of logarithms of primes. Mm-hmm. But you could, if you know the conjectural rationality, then you could get actual equality. Also, the height pairing itself, it is.
What is the conjectural thing that you have alluded to?
Okay, so let me try to say it. So we have.
Maybe you can write again because.
Okay, so let me try to. To do it. Uh-huh. Problem is that it tells that I created all possible whiteboards. Okay, so let me first delete. Just a moment. Okay, so great. Now I can. If you wish. Motif over Q, motif E. Just a moment. Which is extension of, say, I don't know, Q of zero, and then something called weight minus one, say H, I don't know, and Q of one.
Or of
Nori maybe. Maybe in the sense of Nori. Then you can define for every p. You can try to find its abstraction to extending to the whole ZP as an extension of Q of zero by middle extension of H by Q of one. The problem is that you don't have the language. Well, normatives, they work if you work over field of characteristic zero, something like this. But you can ask the corresponding Eliadic question.
Okay.
Then we take middle extension and basically repeat all the words, and then we get a number. And this number will be allowed. Okay. And this you will get for a given P, you will get for all L, you get its Eliadic numbers. But you want it to be actually a rational number, independent of L. And then you can take this rational number with multiply it by log of P, and then sum up everything. And this will be the correct, and then add Archimedean component, which comes from Hodge theory, and then this will be something which depends only on two extensions, Q of zero by H and H by Q of one. The whole E you don't need. Dependence of E disappears of this global, and this would be the global height pairing. But it's defined only in case. Only if you can solve this problem of rationality. And otherwise,
you can prove the compatibility of this, which is the fine modulo of this sum rationality conjecture, with what you considered in the theorem.
Yes, with vanishing cycles. Yes, and it's very simple. So you get E, which has exactly this shape as I wrote, which comes from vanishing cycles, and it's very easy to identify the successive quotients, the two successive quotients, that they actually equal to B. And the reason for this, if you wish, is that you have middle extension there, and middle extension, if you consider on the whole family, there will come middle extension from the complement of singular point of the hypersurface to the whole hypersurface, and this will be primitive cycles on the corresponding quadric, and this is essentially the Bloch cycle. So it's this part is simple.
No, but you didn't define, I remember that you had a paper in the 80s, I think, on IFL, but I don't, in any case, you didn't, in your talk, you wrote B, angular bracket B, you did not say what it is, what the height pairing of the cycle B, which itself is.
Yes, what happened in this work was that it was conditional definition of the height pairing modulo this conjecture of rationality.
So in the theorem, the height pairing of B and B is defined assuming some conjecture, yes?
Yes, itself it is defined assuming conjecture. If you don't assume, it is defined only as element of the quotient of R modulo Q linear combination of logarithms of primes.
And this you can do anyway by another method.
Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry for.
I have a question from the audience. So Bruno Kahn is asking, is E the realization of a one motif in general? Is there a one motif?
No, I think not. It is for a family of curves. But for higher dimension, you will have just something of three consecutive weights. And the middle is not of type, well, 1001, but it could be, well, so it's not one motif in the sense of the length Terry de Hochstra.
Okay. Are there other questions? So let's thank the speaker again.